Thank you very much, Bruce. It's been really fun to come back and visit UC Davis. It's like my scientific home to be back.
Can you turn on the mic?
Oh, yeah. So, yes, thank you for the invitation for the return visit. So the work that I'm going to present today will provide, I think, a nice example of how fundamental research into insect physiology can lead directly to potentially useful, practical tools. So before I start, I just want to gauge who I have in the audience. So how many of you think you know something about aphids? You can raise your hand. Okay. And how many of you know something about plant viruses? Yeah, there's a few obvious ones there. And then what about BT toxins? Okay. So the presentation is in two parts. And as we go through the first part, I would encourage the students and postdocs in particular to watch out and think of ideas of how what I'm presenting can relate to the title of this talk, which is actually Novel Toxin Delivery Strategies for Management of Pestiferous Aphids.
Can you turn the sound up just a little bit?
Okay, is that better? Can you hear it better?
That's all there is.
Okay, I'll try to raise my voice. Is that better? Okay. So I'm going to carry on in the interest of time. So first of all, aphids, they have a tremendous impact on agriculture, both because of the damage caused by direct feeding and then also from the viruses that they transmit. And aphids cause billions of dollars in losses on an annual basis. There are more than 250 species of aphids that feed on crops, and of particular importance in Iowa is the soybean aphid, an invasive species, which has been estimated to cause $1.6 billion in costs over the last decade as a result of yield loss and the cost of management of this single species. So in terms of the viruses, there are more than 275 plant viruses in 19 different genera that are transmitted by aphids, and this number represents about 50% of insect-affected plant viruses. And these include the economically important luteoviruses, such as barley yellow dwarf and a potato leaf roll virus. So aphids have been described as the mosquitoes of the plant world. So our model system is the P. aphid, P. ination mosaic virus system. What we have here is a schematic diagram of the two RNAs, single-stranded positive sense RNAs that comprise the genome of P. EMV. The interesting thing about this is that these two RNAs belong to two taxonomically distinct virus groups. RNA 1 is a luteovirus in the genus Anamnovirus. Well, RNA 2 is a number virus. Now, if you look at RNA 1, it's very similar to a luteovirus genome, the potato leaf roll virus is depicted here, with the exception that this PEMV RNA 1 is missing the movement protein. So this protein is required for movement of the virus in the plant. Now, RNA 2 has the movement protein, but RNA 2 lacks the structural proteins, the coat protein and the read-through domain shown here. So these two RNAs are dependent on one another, RNA 1 on RNA 2 for the movement protein, RNA 2 is dependent on RNA 1 for these structural proteins because RNA 2 also has to be encapsidated to produce this virion structure. We're particularly interested in the structural proteins, the coat protein, and the read-through domain. So 90 to 95% of the time, when the ribosome moves along this sequence, it stops at the UAA stop codon right here. So you end up with a 21 kilodalton coat protein. That's the green shown here. 5 to 10% of the time, you get read-through of that stop codon with the production of a larger protein of about 54 kilodaltons, and the read-through domain protrudes from the surface of the virion, as shown here. And I'll come back to this in a little while. So P. inatia mosaic virus, for the plant pathologists in particular in the room, these are the symptoms. You get characteristic stunting of the plant when you have a PEMV infection. And then you also have these characteristic infoldings or ination of the leaves of the infected plant. Now, in terms of the transmission, the luteoviruses are present in the phloem of a plant. And as the aphid feeds, it ingests the virions. The virions move into the foregut, midgut, and the hindgut. Now, depending on which virus you're talking about, these plant viruses are able to move from the midgut or the hindgut across the epithelial layer into the hemiseal. Now, once you have plant virus in the hemiseal, that aphid will carry that virus for the rest of its life. The virus does not propagate, it doesn't replicate in the aphid, but it's described as circulative because it will circulate in the hemiseal. Now, a smaller proportion of the viruses that make it into the hemiseal will go through the accessory salivary gland and be released when the aphid feeds the next time along with the saliva. And so this is how the aphid transmits the plant virus. So you may see some parallels between mosquito transmission of malaria, Plasmodium parasite, through the gut, out through the salivary glands. So we're particularly interested in events at the gut epithelium. The binding of the virus to a putative receptor, endocytosis into a vesicle, and actual transcytosis. This vesicle moves right across and then is released on the distal side of the epithelial cell into the hemiseal. Now, what we know about this process is based on transmission electron micrographs, largely conducted by Fred Gildow, and summarized here in this schematic. So here we have the virus entering the epithelial cell in clathrin-coated vesicles. There's fusion into this, probably a caviosome-like structure. We have these tubular transporting vesicles that move to the distal side and release the virus. And a similar process at the accessory salivary glands, virus coming in, the endocytosis, these tubular vesicles again, and then release into the salivary duct for transmission. There have been a number of labs that have tried to identify the receptors for plant viruses, for luteoviruses, and this work is summarized here. There's a variety of virus aphid vector combinations. This is barley yellow dwarf virus, beet western yellows, cereal yellow dwarf virus. And in each of these studies, they've started with different tissues depending on what they were looking for. So in this study, they were looking for salivary gland receptors, so they started with head tissues. We have whole aphids, and even one study that used the salivary glands. And there are a number of different proteins identified that bind to these different viruses. And some of them make sense because they're involved in endocytosis, for example, actin and RAC1. But thus far, there's been no receptor identified for a luteovirus. And this study involved a proteomics analysis comparing proteins in vector and non-vector aphid lines, and they identified 50 candidate proteins of interest. So at this point, enter Luke Linz, who is a graduate student in microbiology at Iowa State. And Luke had two things that were important for his work in looking for a receptor for P. inatia mosaic virus. The first were these tools. What we have here are fusion proteins constructs. So we have the coprotein of P. inatia mosaic virus fused to enhanced green fluorescent protein. There's a sequence here which is a proline-rich domain, which actually is derived from the N-terminus of this read-through domain. And the inclusion of this sequence helps with the solubility of this particular protein. And then the second construct is the read-through domain itself fused to EGFP at the N-terminus. So if we go back for a moment to the coprotein and the read-through domain, What we know about the read-through domain is that it's not required for movement of the virus from the gut into the human cell. It is required for transmission. So if you take the read-through domain off, the virus will not go through all the way through the aphid for transmission of the virus. And some recent reports suggest that the read-through domain may bind proteins in the phloem, which in some way facilitates movement of the virus into the aphid, because transmission is facilitated if you include these proteins. But the exact role is not clear at this time. So this is what we know about the read-through domain. Now the second thing that Luke did that nobody else had tried was to use a preparation that was enriched for membrane. So in BT research, brush border membrane vesicles are commonly used to examine the interaction of BT with the membrane of the gut epithelia. So what Luke did was take his unsuspecting aphids and flash freeze them and then homogenize and go through a series of centrifugation steps to enrich for the membrane fraction. And so you end up with this pellet enriched for membrane. And this illustration here shows the kind of vesicle that you might get with the yellow indicating the microvilli. So Luke took his membrane vesicle preparation and separated the proteins by two-dimensional gel electrophoresis, transferred them to a membrane, and conducted a ligand blot. So he would add either his virus or his GFP fusion protein, and then detect bound ligand with primary antibody, and then use a secondary antibody horseradish peroxidase system to detect where the protein was present. So here are his blots when he used the wild type virus. So this is the complete virus with its read-through domain. And he got a very strong binding. It's a high molecular mass. These two images show 2D gels that were run from pH 3 to 10 as opposed to 4 to 7. When he ran the CPP-EGFP fusion, he got the same high molecular mass protein plus a couple of additional proteins lighting up. And this highlights the importance of controls. When he ran GFP alone, he got these two proteins. So the proteins detected here for the GFP fusion were bound by GFP. And when he ran the RTD, the read-through domain fusion, he got many, many proteins lighting up. And these images are representative of at least four replicas for each ligand. So the big question was, what are these proteins, in particular this high molecular mass protein? And so he got sequenced for this, and it turns out to be membrane alanine aminopeptidase N, or APN. And anyone familiar with BT will be gasping at this point. And then he also took some of these proteins that were bound by the read-through domain and got a variety of proteins, including APN and this VATPase subunit, which seems to stick to anything that you test it with. So APN is a putative receptor for PEMV, and in some ways this makes sense based on what we already know. It's very abundant in the PA for gut, and by one estimate, it actually represents 15% of the total gut protein. It is one of the receptors for the cryotoxins derived from Bacillus thuringiensis. It's a secondary receptor. It's also known to be a target for insecticidal mannose binding lectins. And there's also a precedent already for APN as a virus receptor. It's the receptor for some of the group 1 coronaviruses in humans and animals, so these cause respiratory diseases. So in terms of that receptor, Luke is continuing with additional experiments in cell culture to confirm this result. So one of our initial goals was to block the aphid transmission of plant viruses. The objective here is to isolate peptides that will bind to an aphid gut but compete with the plant virus for entry into the aphid hemocele. And the long-term goal is the production of transgenic plants that will block transmission, aphid transmission of plant viruses. So here's a schematic of how this would work. Here's our virus that normally would come in, bind to receptor, and be endocytosed, move into the hemocele. In this case, if you have a transgenic plant, and the virus is present, the peptide is present, the peptide would bind, block the receptor, and the virus would pass straight through the aphid. So that's the concept behind what we're trying to do here. To isolate a peptide that would bind to the aphid gut, we screened a phage display library. This is a filamentous phage system, or the phage is a virus of a bacterium. And these phage, they each display a different 12 amino acid peptide. Each peptide has a conserved cysteine at position 2 and 11. The idea being that it will produce a disulfide bond and give a loop structure to the phage. So how this works is you have your ligand or protein of interest in a plate, you add your library, you wash away any unbound phage, and then elute the bound phage by dropping the pH or adding excess ligand. You take the eluted phage and amplify those, and then you repeat the process 3 times. So each time you go through this process, you are enriching for the phage that lay peptides that bind to your target. Now, this was not our idea. We were following some work conducted by Marcelo Jacobs-Lorena with mosquitoes. They fed mosquitoes on this same phage display library and isolated a peptide that they called SM1 for salivary gland midgut 1. And they established that this peptide blocks entry of Plasmodium not only into the mosquito gut, but also into the salivary glands. They also demonstrated that the peptide is a mimetope, or a mimic of the epitope, of a surface protein on Plasmodium. And they've used this peptide to identify mosquito binding proteins and to more fully understand the interaction of Plasmodium with the mosquito. So Wendy Sparks in my lab screened a phage display library in Heliophis fluorescens and isolated the gut-binding peptide HB1. And this peptide has similarity to a baculovirus ODV envelope protein. So this is the form of the virus that's released from the polyhedra and comes into direct contact with the gut of Heliophis. And she showed that that peptide does compete with baculovirus for binding in the gut. And then finally, Sijun Liu, who identified the aphid gut-binding peptide, which I'll present today. So what Sijun did was he fed the aphids on the phage display library, isolated the mid and hind guts, eluted bound phage, amplified those, and then repeated this 3 times. When he first did the experiment, he sequenced a number of the phage, and they all displayed the same peptide. And that's rather unusual. When you usually do this experiment, you have a number of different sequences. So you repeated the whole thing again and got exactly the same result. So one peptide, which we call the gut-binding peptide 3.1. To confirm the binding of this peptide to the P. aphid gut, we produced EGFP fusion proteins. C6 is a randomly selected non-binding peptide as a negative control. And he could see fluorescence indicating the binding of this fusion in both the midgut and the hindgut of the P. aphid. Wendy Sparks also used a slightly different technique. She used 5 FAM labeled peptides and looked at the guts of different aphid species. So here we have the P. aphid, green peach aphid, and the soybean aphid. And you do see binding to some extent in each of these cases. There's some background here with our negative control. So under these very artificial in vitro conditions, it appears that this peptide may also bind to the guts of other species. So the big question now was, does the peptide compete with the virus, PEMV, for binding to the gut? Now, to do this experiment, Sejan fed the aphids for a period of 16 hours on the either the phage expressing the gut-binding peptide or the negative control, or the EGFP fusions. He then transferred them to virus-infected plants, waited a certain amount of time, and then took the aphids from the plants and used a wax embedding method to collect hemolymph from these aphids. Sejan devised this method to embed the aphids in wax, you remove a leg, and then you collect the hemolymph that comes out. And it's very good, in particular, for avoiding contamination with gut contents, which for this experiment is crucial, because of course the virus will be present in the gut, but we want to know how much is getting into the hemoseal. So then with the hemolymph, he conducted reverse transcription, PCR, for detection of the viral RNA. So these are the results. This is what you see if there's no peptide or phage. Under the conditions used for RT-PCR, you could detect viral RNA 25 minutes after the aphids were placed on the infected plants. When he fed the aphids first on the negative control peptide, phage expressing peptide C6, a similar result, he could detect virus in the aphid hemoseal at 30 minutes. When he fed the aphids first on the phage displaying the gut-binding peptide, he continued the experiment for 80 minutes on the plant and did not detect virus at all in the hemoseal. And when he tried the peptide EGFP fusions, for the negative control, detection was at 30 minutes, and then for the peptide EGFP, gut-binding peptide EGF fusion, detection began at about 80 minutes after the aphids had been transferred to those infected plants. So Sejan then used quantitative RT-PCR to look at the relative virus load in the aphids. What you can see here is at 30 minutes feeding on the infected plants and 60, there was a significant difference in the virus that made it into the hemoseal when aphids were first fed on the gut-binding peptide compared to the negative control. But by 90 minutes on the plant, there was no significant difference. And what he used for the positive control here was RNA isolated from whole aphids after 20 minutes on the infected plant. So this includes, he would detect the virus present in the gut of the aphid. And the negative control was aphids fed for only 15 minutes and then the hemolymph isolated. And you do see that with qPCR, you can detect the virus. It's a lot more sensitive than the RT-PCR used in the previous experiment. So our thoughts on this are that with continued feeding on the plant, the peptide that the aphids were fed on first may have been degraded, dislodged, or outcompeted by the virus. But if you had a transgenic plant expressing the peptide, it may be effective at impeding the uptake of the virus into the aphid. And then it's not known at this time how much virus you have to have in the aphid before you get transmission. So how this would work? A typical scenario is the infected aphid comes into your field and infects the plant. The population grows, and then aphids move from that plant to the neighboring plant. And they all become infected, and then the infection spreads. If we have the peptide locking strategy, you cannot save that first plant. So the viriliferous aphid will come in and infect that first plant, but you won't get transmission from that first plant to the neighboring plants. So that's how that would work. So to summarize this section, we isolated an aphid gut-binding peptide by screening a phage display library. The gut binding was confirmed by use of GFP fusion proteins. It appears that it will bind the gut epithelial cells of other aphid species under in vitro conditions. And the peptide does appear to impede the uptake of P. ination mosaic virus into the hemoseal of the P. aphid.
Could I ask a quick question?
Yes.
Why is that?
Right. So the question is, if the plants, the transgenic plants, are expressing the gut-binding peptide, how come that when the aphid flies in and it probes, it gets infected? So the aphid will release saliva into that plant, carrying the virus. So where the peptide blocking works is for the next aphid that comes along and feeds, it will ingest the peptide as well as the virus. And then the peptide blocks and the virus can't go through the gut. Yes. So the burning question is, does the peptide bind APN? And the answer is, we don't know, so stay tuned. But if you remember the green fluorescent midgut and hindgut, if it does bind APN, that's not the only thing it binds to, because APN is not present in the hindgut of the aphid. So this is my transition slide to check on my audience. This is some of the Department of Entomology at Iowa State University. So does anybody have any ideas about how this information could be used to retarget toxins? And that's okay if you don't. Now, at the same time that Zijun was working with the gut-binding peptide, Huazhen Li was working in the lab to try to understand the physiological basis for why BT toxins don't work particularly well against P. aphids. So the question was raised, will addition of the P. aphid gut-binding peptide to a BT toxin increase the binding of the toxin to the gut and enhance the toxicity against the aphids? So to address this question, we selected a cytolytic toxin, which is another type of BT toxin, so derived from these bacteria. And the reason to use this one is, first of all, the mode of action of the cytotoxins is much simpler than the mode of action of the cryotoxins, which require processing and primary receptors and secondary receptors. Secondly, the cytotoxin is toxic for mosquito larvae. So if we modify this toxin, we can test it in mosquito larvae to see if the modifications that we made resulted in loss of toxicity. And thirdly, this cytotoxin does actually show low-level toxicity already against the P. aphid and the green peach aphid, but the levels are very low toxicity, with LC50 of much greater than 150 micrograms per mil, which is not reasonable for pest management purposes. So this is how the cytotoxin works, or the two scenarios of how it might work. You have a water-soluble monomer. The monomer attaches to the membrane. Oligomers are produced in association with the membrane, and they either form a pore in this manner, or they disrupt the membrane in the detergent model. But the result of either scenario is that you have a leaky membrane. So we produced a series of Site2AA GBP 3.1 fusions. This shows a model structure of Site2AA. We have alpha helices and beta sheets in the central part. And the structure tells us that there are seven loops on the exterior of this protein, labeled here. Now we know that loop 6 is involved in the mode of action of this toxin, so we did not modify this particular loop. But we added our peptide sequence, shown here in purple, to each of the other loops. And these are called Seagal mutants. So Site2AA, GBP 3.1 addition, because we added the peptide to the existing sequence, and then the loop and number. So we had 6 mutants that we're working with. So Nana Chowbali in the lab first addressed whether modification of these toxins by addition of the peptide increased the toxin binding to aphid gut brush border membrane vesicles. So in this case, he actually dissected the guts to prepare these vesicles. And in these pull-down assays, the way this works is you take your membrane vesicles, you add BT toxin, you centrifuge so that the membrane precipitates, and then you examine the precipitate to see how much toxin is associated with it. So with wild-type Site2AA, he didn't detect any toxin by Western blot. But in all cases, the addition of the peptide increased to varying extents the amount of toxin associated with the membrane. 1, 3, 4, and 7 in particular brought increased binding. So then Nana went ahead and tested whether these modifications had altered the toxicity against mosquito larvae. And actually the toxin action of Seagull 2, 5, and 7 was indeed reduced by addition of the peptide. So the peptide had disrupted the structure so the toxin no longer functioned correctly. But the other three, 1, 3, and 4, looked fine relative to site 2AA. So no significant differences here against Aedes aegypti larvae. So then he tested the P-aphid. Here is the LC50 for the wild type toxin, which you could not actually determine. And you can see there's a massive increase in the toxicity against the P-aphid. And these were determined at day 4 or day 3 for Seagull 1, 3, or 4. And the toxicity between these three are not significantly different. We also did bioassays with green peach aphid, and again, we got a significant increase in the toxicity, but the increase was not as great as seen for the pea aphid. But remember that our peptide was selected in the pea aphid, so not against the green peach aphid. But this does suggest that we will see increased binding to other aphid species as well. So Nana then examined the guts of some of these insects. So here is a normal aphid, healthy-looking microvilli in the midgut of the aphid. You do see some disruption with the wild-type toxin, but you see drastic disruption when you feed these aphids on the Seagull 1, as an example. And this is second instars, fed on 100 micrograms per mil for 3 days. So to summarize the second part, site 2AA shows only low toxicity against the P aphid. We have this aphid gut-binding peptide. Addition of the peptide to site 2AA at loops 1, 3, and 4 did not affect the mosquitocidal activity, but did enhance the aphicidal activity. Whereas addition to loops 2, 5, and 7 resulted in reduced toxicity against mosquito larvae. The aphid toxicity was associated with damage to the gut epithelial membrane, and these Seagull proteins were more toxic to the P. aphid than to Myiasis persicae. And this schematic shows a model for the insertion of site 2AA into the cell membrane. And what I've done here is highlight loops 1, 3, and 4. So these are the ones that became when we added the peptide, we got a more active toxin against aphids. And they all remain on the surface. Loops 5 and 7 are inserted through the epithelial layer membrane. And so we actually lost toxicity by addition here. And here's loop 2, which is also on the surface. So in terms of where this project is now going, we are working to find out whether you can do the same thing with the cryotoxins. If you add the peptide to cryotoxin, can we target it against an aphid of economic importance, specifically the soybean aphid? And then secondly, in theory, this technology could be used for any pest of interest. You could select a peptide using the phage display library, four peptides that bind the gut of your targeted species. And so we are still focusing on hemipteran pests, but in theory it could be applied to any pest. So the last few minutes, I just want to tell you about the second technology, but not in any detail. Remember this slide about the virus moving from the gut into the human cell. So a number of years ago, after an Iowa State University Virology Journal Club, I had a discussion with Alan Miller, who is a plant pathologist, and he said he'd always wondered whether you could take a coat protein, one of these virus coat proteins, and attach it to something, if it would deliver that protein or toxin from the gut into the humor cell. Now in terms of insect pest management, all of the toxins that are currently used are gut toxins. So BT toxins, lectins, but there's this whole slew of other toxins, neurotoxins in particular, that represent an untapped resource for insect pest management. So here we have a few of the animals that produce venomous toxins that include insect-specific toxins. So we've got spiders, scorpions, mites, parasitoid wasps, and even sea anemones. So to test Alan's idea, we use this same construct that Luke used, the coprotein fused to the EGFP, and fed aphids on PDS, GFP alone, or this fusion. And aphids, they do have some background fluorescence, but what we see in this case is very bright fluorescence along the dorsal aorta of the aphid. Now, this is the site of the pericardial cells, which regulate hemolymph composition by synthesizing and releasing some proteins and then removing other things and taking them out of the hemolymph. So this result actually told us that yes, indeed, the coprotein alone, without the virion structure, is sufficient to move something from the gut into the heme seal. And then obviously something, we don't know at the moment whether it's the coprotein or the GFP, is recognized by the pericardial cells and then cleared, and we assume degraded. To test this for practical control purposes, we've used this model toxin, omega atrocitoxin HV1A, which is derived from the Australian funnel web spider. This is in collaboration with Glenn King. This is a calcium channel blocker. It's a highly stable toxin. It's very easy to work with. It is orally active against some invertebrates, including ticks and some moth pests, but it's not orally active against aphids. But it is toxic to aphids by injection, so this is the perfect toxin to test our hypothesis. So we have shown that coprotein is sufficient to deliver toxins into the aphid hemoseal, and bioassays conducted in planter do show promise for use of this luteovirus coprotein toxin fusion for aphid management purposes. So finally, to acknowledge some of the players, Luke Lintz was funded by USDA to do the PEMV receptor work. Xijun Liu isolated the aphid gut-binding peptide. Huazhen Li and Nana Chowgli, funded by Consortium for Plant Biotechnology Research and Dow AgroSciences, produced the modified toxins with the peptide attached. Narinder Pal has been working on the coprotein delivery system for toxins. And then finally, Alan Miller, our long-term pathology collaborator. Thank you for your attention.
Brandy will take a few questions. I'm going to have to vanish and turn this over to Walter in a few minutes. But since we have to exit the room in 15 minutes, there will also be continued discussion in 2:56.
Great question.
I have a
filter
for the rest of the room is actually
gone. Oh, is that right? Yeah. That's great. We have 2 hours.
I just have a question as you might project into the future. If you were able to deploy this strategy, what would you predict for development of resistance in the aphid? Do you think that would be an issue, or could this strategy bypass some of that response to toxins?
Right, so you're talking about transgenic plants expressing the modified seagull toxins.
Well, I actually don't know how you're planning to deliver either of these, either transgenic plants or by some other barrier.
Yeah, so it would be transgenic plants, because to target aphids, you have to have that protein in the phloem so they would ingest it. So if you hit an insect population strong enough, hard enough, and repeatedly, you will always get resistance. That's across the board, whether you're talking about chemical insecticides or BT toxins. So this would be another tool that, in theory, should be used in integrated pest management or with the refuge system that's currently established for the transgenic plants.
Well, it seems like though, the resistance could accumulate, because we know within the population there are vector, efficient vectors and non-efficient vectors, right? And those non-efficient vectors, if they're not binding, they can be all of a sudden selected for. If you're using the virus interaction, I think that there to deliver that.
So at the moment, we don't know what exactly the peptide is binding to. So we don't know if it is the same receptor as the virus receptor.
Is the sequence of the GPV311, is that found at all in the virus protein or read-through region?
No, and that was the first thing we thought, because we thought, okay, well, with the other phage display library systems where we isolated peptides, we could find similarity to, say, baculovirus co-protein. In this case, there was nothing. The peptide sequence is not similar to anything. But if you look at the hydrophobicity plots, they do look similar to one particular region of the co-protein of the PEMV. But it's not something you can see by looking at the actual amino acid sequence. Chris?
Right, how do you move this into real life repository?
Right, so the question is, how do you move it into real agriculture? Now, the first thing is that you need to get very friendly with your industry representative and find out actually what their target pest is. I thought that with this system and with some other technologies, that all we had to do was prove the concept that it could work, and then some company would take it and do the transgenic plants, and in 10 years we would have transgenic soybeans planted in Iowa, resistant to aphids. So what actually happened was, they said, oh yeah, that's great, really exciting. Aphids are not our priority pest. So so we are working now to adapt this technology to other insects that are industry's priority pests, other Hemiptera.
Would each insect be a separate regulatory path?
That's a good question. So. There's so much regulation already relating to BT toxins that I think if you're taking a toxin like a crytoxin that's already approved for use and modifying that, the hurdles may be less than if you're starting with a brand new toxin that's not currently used in the field. But I haven't looked into that in detail. I think, though, when you're talking about transgenic plants, it's such a huge undertaking, and it takes so long, and there's so many hurdles that have to be cleared before they can actually be marketed, that it's not something a university could do. You need one of the big ag industries.
Could you potentially develop a BT itself, a modified BT, rather than a modified plant?
Yes, for spraying BT toxins. Yes, but it won't work for phloem or xylem feeders, because you need to obviously have the toxin where the insect is going to take it up and adjust it. Yes?
At the beginning of your talk, it shows how much the aphids and the transmission of the diseases, how much injury it causes. Why aren't the aphids a prime target for industry?
I think, maybe Bryce could comment on this too, but my impression is that when you look at that, there's all kinds of crops, and the industries, they tend to have the crops that they focus on. So unless you have a disease that's really important in their crop of interest, and a lot of them may be more small sort of vegetable production systems. The other thing, okay. So the peptide blocking strategy, I took it to the CPBR and put up my poster, and they said, oh yeah, that's a great idea, but you have to kill the aphid. If you manage the plant virus, that's only half of the problem, because you've got yield loss because the aphid is there and it's feeding and reproducing. So they really want to focus on the vector rather than on the plant virus.
Well, the place where they want to kill the Hemiptera in citrus, in the Asian citrus zone.
So I should move to Florida, right?
Well, no, you don't need to move there. You can do the work, though.
Yes, okay.
Not just Florida, so you're gonna have to leave California now.
That's right.
Yes.
Another question? Going back to Bruce's question, if you could devise one insect-specific one, there would be some advantage to that, and there would be also some drawback. That would be so specific for that particular insect, and if you have a number of insects in the field, then you have to devise one for each other. The same problem that we face always with pheromones, that are so specific, there's advantage and disadvantage at the same time, right?
Yes, now, so we know with this particular toxin that there are three loops that we can add peptides to. So you could imagine a scenario where you select three peptides against three different pests in your cropping system and then put them all into one toxin, or you have three different toxins expressed by one transgenic plant to target all of your pests at the same time.
I know that Eric is thinking there, how this is going to affect my bees? And you may have an answer for that, right?
We would test the bees. Yes, that's the
number
one.
At this point, do you have any idea that's ineffective in bees? Is it innocuous in bees at this point?
I'm trying to think of any literature on BT toxins affecting bees at all, and I'm not recalling anything.
Randy, what about the idea of trying to move it into use in countries where the need is much greater and the regulation is a bit lower? Africa, Asia.
Yes. When is the next Gates Foundation deadline? Yes. Yes, that's definitely a possibility. And there is increasing interest in transferring new ideas to help developing countries.
I believe that's much time with the students, and for that reason, the students are quiet when they ask any questions.
On the surface of the virion, as shown here, and I'll come back to this in a little while. So, P. inatia mosaic virus, for the plant pathologists in particular in the room, these are the symptoms. You get characteristic stunting of the plant when you have a PEMV infection. And then you also have these characteristic infoldings or innation of the leaves of the infected plant. Now, in terms of the transmission, the luteoviruses are present in the phloem of a plant. And as the aphid feeds, it ingests the virions. The virions move into the foregut, midgut, and the hindgut. Now, depending on which virus you're talking about, these plant viruses are able to move from the midgut or the hindgut across the epithelial layer into the heme seal. Now, once you have plant virus in the heme seal, that aphid will carry that virus for the rest of its life. The virus does not propagate, it doesn't replicate in the aphid, but it's described as circulative because it will circulate in the heme seal. Now, a small proportion of the viruses that make it into the heme seal will go through the accessory salivary gland and be released when the aphid feeds the next time along with the saliva. And so this is how the aphid transmits the plant virus. So you may see some parallels between mosquito transmission of malaria, Plasmodium parasite, through the gut, out through the salivary gland. The interesting thing about this is that these two RNAs belong to two taxonomically distinct virus groups. RNA 1 is a luteovirus in the genus Anamnovirus, while RNA 2 is a number virus. Now, if you look at RNA 1, it's very similar to a luteovirus genome. The potato leaf roll virus is depicted here, with the exception that this PEMV RNA 1 is missing the movement protein. So this protein is required for movement of the virus in the plant. Now, RNA 2 has the movement protein, but RNA 2 lacks the structural proteins, the coat protein and the read-through domain shown here. So these two RNAs are dependent on one another, RNA1 on RNA2 for the movement protein, RNA2 is dependent on RNA1 for these structural proteins because RNA2 also has to be encapsulated to produce this virion structure. We're particularly interested in the structural proteins, the coprotein and the read-through domain. So 90 to 95% of the time, when the ribosome moves along this, this sequence, it stops at the UAA stop codon right here. So you end up with a 21 kilodalton coprotein. That's the green shown here. 5 to 10% of the time, you get read-through of that stop codon with the production of a larger protein, of about 54 kilodaltons, and the read-through domain protrudes from Thank you very much, Bruce. It's been really fun to come back and visit UC Davis. It's like my scientific home to be back here.
I need to turn on the mic.
Oh, yeah. So yes, thank you for the invitation for the return visit. So the work that I'm going to present today will provide, I think, a nice example of how fundamental research into insect physiology can lead directly to potentially useful, practical tools. So before I start, I just want to gauge who I have in the audience. So how many of you think you know something about aphids? You can raise your hand. Okay. And how many of you know something about plant viruses? Yeah, there's a few obvious ones there. And then what about BT toxins? Okay. So I'm going to, the presentation is in two parts. And as we go through the first part, I would encourage the students and postdocs in particular to watch out and think of ideas of how what I'm presenting can relate to the title of this talk, which is actually Novel Toxin Delivery Strategies for Management of Pestiferous Aphids.
Can you turn the sound up just a little bit?
Is that better? Can you hear it better?
That's all there is.
Okay. So we're particularly interested in events at the gut epithelium. The binding of the virus to a putative receptor, endocytosis into a vesicle, and actual transcytosis. This vesicle moves right across and then is released on the distal side of the epithelial cell into the haemocyte. Now, what we know about this process is based on transmission electron micrographs, largely conducted by Fred Gildow, and summarized here in this schematic. So here we have the virus entering the epithelial cell in clathrin-coated vesicles. There's fusion into this, probably a caviosome-like structure. We have these tubular transporting vesicles that move to the distal side and release the virus. And a similar process at the accessory salivary glands, virus coming in, the endocytosis, these tubular vesicles again, and then release into the salivary duct for transmission. There have been a number of labs that have tried to identify the receptors for plant viruses, for luteaviruses. And this work is summarized here. There's a variety of virus aphid vector combinations. This is barley yellow dwarf virus, beet western yellows, cereal yellow dwarf virus. And in each of these studies, they've started with different tissues depending on what they were looking for. So in this study, they were looking for salivary gland receptors, so they started with head tissues. We have whole aphids, and even one study, try to raise my voice. Is that better? Okay. So I'm going to carry on in the interest of time. So first of all, aphids, they have a tremendous impact on agriculture, both because of the damage caused by direct feeding and then also from the viruses that they transmit. And aphids cause billions of dollars in losses on an annual basis. There are more than 250 species of aphids that feed on crops, a particular importance in Iowa is the soybean aphid, an invasive species, which is, has been estimated to cause $1.6 billion in costs over the last decade as a result of yield loss and the cost of management of this single species. So in terms of the viruses, there are more than 275 plant viruses in 19 different genera that are transmitted by aphids, and this number represents about 50% of insect-affected plant viruses. And these include the economically important luteaviruses, such as barley yellow dwarf and a potato leaf roll virus. So aphids have been described as the mosquitoes of the plant world. So our model system is the P-aphid, P-ination mosaic virus system. What we have here is a schematic diagram of the two RNAs, single-stranded positive sense RNAs that comprise the genome of PEMV.